And so, okay, so let's, I don't know if I can remember the order in which I asked those questions, but I think the first one was, why in the world were you compelled to object? And what is it that you were objecting to, do you think?
Well, it's a funny question for you to pose to me, because I have the feeling that the answer will be entirely native to you. I literally don't believe I had any choice. People frequently ask me why I stood up. And my sense is, if I think through the alternative, I simply can't live with it. I can't sleep.
Yeah, right? But that doesn't seem to bother most people. So I don't get that. Well, like, why you?
Well, right. I mean, I guess that's the thing I'm discovering. So you alluded to my political leanings, and you and I both know what you mean by that. I'm a liberal, and I describe myself sometimes as a reluctant radical. By that, I mean that I believe we must engage in radical change if we are to survive as a species, but I also know that radical change is very dangerous. And so it's not like, you know, I find most people who would call themselves radicals feel like radical change is always called for. And I don't. My sense is, I hope to see change that makes civilization good enough that I get to be a conservative, that I get to say, actually, we're doing so well that we have no choice but to preserve this. If we try to improve it, we'll mess it up. That's where I want to go. But what I'm discovering is that the bedrock of my liberalism is nothing like the underpinnings of the so-called liberalism of most of the people on the left side of the political spectrum. My liberalism comes from a sense that, yes, compassion is a virtue, but that policy must be based on a dispassionate analysis of problems. It is based on an understanding that the magic of the West comes from a tension between those who aspire to change things for the better and those who recognize the danger of changing them at all. And so in any case, I think the short answer is, we look around the world and everybody makes arguments that sound as if they come from first principles, but most people do not arrive at conclusions from first principles. If they extrapolate at all, they don't do it very well. And that results in a severe compartmentalization of thought. And that means that when confronted with changes that threaten a system on which we are dependent, most people don't recognize it. And if they do recognize it, they wouldn't know what to do about it. So how can I put it in plain terms? I had no choice, because I was as if on a ship where somebody had proposed to fix our course through a field of icebergs and navigate based on some absurd theory with no grounding in fact. Somebody had to object. And I was a little surprised at how few and far between the objectors were.